Praise the Lord. Because of your presence in this place, Lord, we thank you. For all that you have, we thank you. For what you are going to do tonight, we worship you. Glory to your name, Father. Father, give us the word of understanding, Lord. Give us the heart to receive. Give us the power of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding in the name of Jesus. Have mercy on us, Lord. Father, tonight, Lord Jesus, in this night vigil, Lord, it will be a program never to forget in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, it will be a program to reckon with in our life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you because you are going to do wonders and mighty things tonight, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. In Jesus' name. Let's sit. Let me sit there. Amen. I just want to give us some word of encouragement tonight before we go into prayers in the book of John chapter 5. John chapter 5. John chapter 5. From verse 1, then. From verse 1. There's a story. Yeah, there's a story there that we have to read. And I will read it quickly.
After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And there was a feast of the Jews. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue by Bethesda, having five porches. In this lay a great multitude of invalids, for a fox, of blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and turned the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been now a long time in that condition, he said unto him, "Will you be made whole?" The invalid man answered him, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another step down before me." Verse 8. Jesus said unto him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And that same day was the Sabbath. Then the Jews therefore said unto him that was cured,
"Amen.
The Sabbath day,
amen. That's okay, man.
Carry your bed."
That is okay, man. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, my sister. God bless you. Amen. Here we saw the story of a man. Like I said, it's just the work of encouragement. We are here for only prayers. It's just a word of encouragement to steer up our faith and to get our understanding into some certain things about our Lord Jesus. Because the way he was on his earthly ministry, that's still the way he is in heaven. He has never changed. He doesn't change. The same Jesus that you knew, that you know and you heard about in those days, is still the same Jesus that is on the throne in heaven. He doesn't change. The way he behaves that time, that's still the way he behaves. Amen.
Amen.
The only difference that happened is just he parted from the from his body appearance. He departed from the body and is now living in the spirit, which means it's no longer living among us, but is now living among us in spirit. So it does not change. And Jesus was walking by. He went to Jerusalem during the feast there. And he walked by this pool. Because the pool was a very significant one in Jerusalem in those days. Because in those days, even before Jesus was born, before the manifestation of Jesus on earth, the pool had always been. And the people always believed in God even before Jesus came. And the people were always, the sick people, the lame, the blind, and all the other people that are sick, they're always sitting by the pool. And the Bible said the pool had five porches, which means like it has five pillars. And there was tents, and the tents will protect the people that are sitting under it from rain and sun. And people were sitting down there as long as possible. They will sit down until they receive their healing. And the Bible made us understand that the angel of the Lord always coming to the heart once in a while, once in a year to stir the water. And whosoever jumps first into the pool that will get cleansed first from all infirmity. Now, if that should be the case, that the angel will come once in a while to stir the water and anyone that jumps in will get ill first. That means there's a trouble if there are 5,000 or more sitting there by the pool. Because some people will never get healed, they will never get the miracle until the end of their lifetime. It's a serious business. People will sit down by the pool, and according to the theologians, they say those punches represent the house of mercy that suspended our grace. The house of mercy suspended by five punches of grace. They were sitting under mercy. Mercy that was suspended by grace. Yet they were sitting down and they were still expecting the angel to come to stir the water. Mercy was in place. Grace was in place. Yet they sat down waiting for the stirring of the water. I want you to pick up my word one by one before I get to where I'm going. It had five punches and shade that people were sitting under them. And I said it represents the grace and the mercy of God. A house of mercy suspended by five pillars of grace. And people sat in that place and still expecting miracle and manners from above. I want you to sink that meaning to your mind before I even get to where I'm going. And this man was expecting that touch from above. Inside a place of grace and mercy. And he did not receive his healing for 38 good years. 38 good years. He was sitting down at the pool. Imagine somebody sitting down waiting for a miracle for 38 years. You know that when you see that kind of person, you will know. Immediately you will know that this man has been long here. And when Jesus went into the place, he discovered immediately that this man definitely must have been long in this place. I want to believe that other people got saved that day. But the most important one was what the Bible recorded. Bible always record the most important story. It doesn't mean that many other things did not happen there. But they record the most important one. This man was there 38 years waiting for his miracles, waiting for his healing. The Bible says his own situation was a complicated one. You know, people were, the blind people, I mean, if someone is blind and at least you can walk, when you hear the steering or the manifestation of the angel, you just quickly, one way or the other, you rush into the pool. But this man's case was worse. He couldn't see and he couldn't walk. How can that kind of person go into the pool? It was a complicated issue, a hopeless situation. And that is the reason why I believe he spent 38 years waiting for miracle. But all of a sudden, the owner and the dispenser of miracle appeared into the pool. The person that sent the angel from above to come and steer the pool came in person to the pool. And he was talking face to face with the man that needed miracle. No wonder the Bible says, the word turned into the flesh and dwelleth among us. The word, that was what Jesus was called in the beginning. Because the Bible said in the beginning there was Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. Without Him, nothing was done. Through Him, everything was created. So He was the Word manifested in person. The owner of the angels, the commander of the battalion of angels, came in person. And the man did not know Him. The man did not recognize the owner of angels, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Lion of Judah. No wonder Jesus said to that woman in chapter 4 of that same John, He said, if you know who asked you to give you to give him water, you wouldn't have said otherwise. You would have rushed quickly to go and bring it, because you didn't know who is talking to you. Because the man did not know who was talking. The man did not know. The man was still expecting the... And look at... As soon as Jesus walked to him, Jesus asked him a question. Do you want to be made whole? Verses. Do you want to be made whole? And what was the response of that man? Look at verse 7. The sick man answered him and said, Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool. When the water is stirred up, anytime the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another creeps down before me. Verse 8. And Jesus said to him, Rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole. Amen. Now Jesus was asking him, Do you need healing? Do you need to be made whole? Because he saw a situation that was helpless and hopeless. And instead of the man to say, Yes, I need healing, the man started complaining. He started telling Jesus the reason why he was there for 38 years. He said, You don't know me, son, my son, or sir, or respect. He gave Jesus a respect. I have been here for a long time. I have been around this pool for a long time. In my presence here, in my physical height, many thousands, maybe that was what he was trying to say. Many people have gone into the water before I jump in. You can see my case is worse. It's not only that I was blind, and I couldn't even maneuver myself into the pool. Before I got into the pool, another one entered. And that is why I am here for 38 years. He must have told Jesus the number of years that he was at the pool. That was why he was recorded. I have been here for 38 good years waiting at this pool. And you are here asking me a question whether I want to be made whole or not. If I don't want to be made whole, what will I be doing beside the pool? All I need is a helper. All I need is somebody to help me. If I could get somebody that would say, what he was saying indirectly, what he was trying to negotiate for, if Jesus will be able to stay a year or so with him at the pool there, and maybe whenever the angel comes, Jesus will just carry him and put him. He was looking for a helper in a different way. Amen.
Amen.
He was looking for another helper. He wanted his miracle in another dimension. He had his own mindset regarding the kind of miracle he wanted. The common miracle that everybody was receiving, that was what he positioned himself to receive. And that was the miracle of the pool. Any other ways of miracle, he didn't know. And his faith did not abide, his faith was not in any kind of other miracle, apart from the miracle of the pool at Bethesda. And that was why he was waiting for 38 years. Amen. And he saw miracle live and direct, and the owner of miracle came in person. And he was still telling the man that I'm still expecting the movement of the angel, the movement of the water by the angel. And if only you will stand with me, I need a help. I need support. I need assistance. As soon as the angel comes, if you can just lead me in, then I believe I will be made whole. And that is the reason why I'm here today. To change our mindset from focusing on the answers of our problem to one channel. A lot of people have been waiting for so long in one junction. You are sitting at the bus stop waiting for a bus to a destination. And when you see one that is actually going to your direction, you did not recognize, or you don't even recognize them. The Lord is sending the word to you today. And that is what we are going to, our prayer is going to channel towards some certain things tonight. And that is why I want to speak to you first before we go into those prayers. When you are expecting things from God, no matter how long it can be, I don't know whether it's a week, 2 weeks, 1 month, 6 months, 1 year that you have been asking God, and you have been looking in your own direction, say, this is the way I'm expecting this miracle. At least this healing will come from here. At least, you know, I'm telling you today that God does not work in our own plans. God does not work in the way we walk. God does not work in the way of man. He is the great God and the might. He is the greatest God and the greatest that you can ever see in this world. The mightier than the mightiest. The most wonderful God. When he appears in your situation, no matter how long, no matter how terrible, no matter how difficult, the situation must give way. The Son of God appeared at the pool and he turned the life story of this man, he turned his sorrow into dancing. And that was the reason why we sang that song before we sat down, that you lay down your trouble, your sorrow, your pain, and you exchange it for the joy of the Lord. Amen. But tonight, in the name of Jesus, I decree that somebody here, you will lay down your sorrow for the garment of dancing in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
So it is dangerous for you to have a man's mind, especially when you are praying. You already have a mind that this is the way God will do it for me. I don't know how best to say this. You pray for something you are expecting, but your expectant is towards another direction. You don't have to expect in any direction when you pray to God. All you must know is that the Lord is able. He that has promised to do it is well able to accomplish his promises. All you must know is that he said he would do it, and he must do it. All you must know that he has promised is what he has promised in his word, and he can never fail. Then it says that song that says, he has promised, he will never fail. I rely on him, I will follow him. He has promised, he will never fail. His faithfulness is forevermore. His faithfulness is forevermore. When the Lord promises, the book of 1 John chapter 5 verse 17, I believe, it says, now this is the covenant that we have in him, that whenever we ask anything according to his word, his purpose, his will, he will do it for us.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If we ask anything according to his purpose, according to his will, he will do it for us.
Amen.
The only reason why you cannot receive is if it's not according to his will. Amen.
Amen.
And this word says his plan and purpose for us is of good and not of evil. Amen.
Amen.
To bring every of our expectations, our good expectations that has to work together with him to pass. That is what we must know. It is not our job to begin to design how it's going to come. Which way will it come? What year will it come? What time will it come? How will it manifest? That is not our own working. It is not our assignment. It is God's assignment to decide when he will do it. It is our own assignment to pray for it and hope persistently for it. Amen.
Amen.
Our inability to, if we begin to design how God will do or answer your prayer, it makes you stay in one place for a long time. Because that is the beginning of unfaithfulness. That is the beginning. When you do not have faith in God, answers of the prayer cannot come. The answer comes through faith. The Lord has not promised us anywhere in the Bible that we will not encounter difficulties even when we are serving him. But our ability to obey the word that we read and refer him back to all his promises concerning our lives, and standing in faith daily in him, turn situation around for us. And I'm telling you, for any step we cross further, we cross onto miracle. For instance, what I mean is that when a child, or when a school, when school children go to school, and whenever they sit for exam, the exam is a sign that a child wants to get promotion to another class. So, and when the child passes the examination, he gets promoted, and the promotion comes with signs, you know, with pride, with joy, and jubilation. And that is what it is when child of God has a problem. When we have any kind of problem, we are encountering something or the other, or we are waiting on the Lord for one thing or the other, and we have been waiting no matter how long or how short, we must believe that the Lord has promised and He will do it. Because the quicker you begin to believe in Him, the quicker the manifestation of your miracle. Let me repeat what I said. The faster you are beginning to trust Him that He can do it, the faster your miracle manifests. The more you doubt, the more you question your belief, the more you use your head to plan, the farther and the longer the answer of your prayer is. The answer to your prayer becomes. And I'm telling you, this is true. I'm not just saying it from my head. I am saying it from experience and from what I know. When you ask God for anything and you begin to design plans for yourself, you begin to have expectations for yourself, you begin to get results in your mind and how God, you believe God will bring this.
Amen.
Then the farther and the longer the answers will be to come. And it will make you stay in a place for a long time. But the more you begin to look at that problem as if they don't exist, the more you begin to trust, you know, you don't look at the problem, but you look at the promises. But the problem with we human beings or Christians of nowadays, we focus too much on problems instead of focusing on the promises. Lord, this is not your promise for me. This is not what you have promised. This is not what you said will happen to me. This is not what you begin to quote Bible verses that say those things and those things and those things. And before you know it, your faith gets you, in the summary of what I'm saying is that your faith gets you out of trouble quicker than your worries. Worry cannot get you anywhere. Trouble, confusion cannot get you anywhere, but your faith does, and as quicker as possible. And I'm not saying it, I used to tell people, I don't talk because I want you to feel happy. I'm talking because the Bible says so, and because I believe so. Somebody have problem. I want to compare some people that have problem in the Bible. In the book of Matthew, if you read Matthew in chapter 11, you will see a man of God that had problem there. He was in prison. And this man of God was in prison. Can you turn to Matthew 11 quickly? I don't want anybody to be sleeping. Huh? We have not even started at all. Praise the Lord, Sister Antonia.
Hallelujah, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Matthew 11, are we there?
Yes, sir.
Can you read from verse 2? I will read quickly from verse 2. And when John had heard in prison about the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to him, "Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and tell John the things which you have, which you hear and see. The blind see, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me." And they departed. Jesus began to say to the multitude concerning John, "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, I'm more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.' Assuredly, I say to you, among those Born of women, there are not risen one greater than John the Baptist, but he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than him. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of God suffered violence, and the violent taketh it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to receive it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears, let him hear. Amen.
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 You see, now I want to establish the fact that people, they expect, they put their, when they pray, they expect answer from somewhere. Even the whole John the Baptist, the wonderful forerunner of Jesus, the supernatural prophet that was standing in, that was what Jesus was saying there. He would say, who do you see in the desert? Look at the way he was a mighty one in the wilderness. He was a powerful one. That was what Jesus was trying to say. But the same person, Jesus was disappointed in him. Despite how powerful he is. I mean, he was. John the Baptist was very powerful. If he released any word in that prison yard, it would happen. And he was expecting Jesus to come and speak a word to get him out of that place. Or maybe Jesus will organize some prayer warrior program. And they will just pray and the prison will just open and they will come out. That was expectation of John the Baptist. He was disappointed. In fact, he took offense. That Jesus, you heard that I was inside here. Now tell me, how would John the Baptist ask question again? Are you the one to come, or we should expect another one? When he was the one that baptized Jesus.
Yes.
He was the one that baptized him.
Yes.
And when he baptized him, the heavens opened. He saw it.
Yes.
And the dove came into Jesus. He saw it.
Yes.
And the voice came from heaven. He heard it. And the voice said, this is my beloved son. Hear him. He heard it.
Yes.
And when trouble came, John the Baptist forgot all those things. Just all of a sudden. Just like we do. Today, when God gives us money, oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. God is good. We are happy. When we receive blessing from God, oh, it's very powerful. But after 2 weeks, when bad times came, I mean, comes, if bad time comes, we forget it immediately what God did last week. That's the way we are, we Christians. God provides heavy miracle yesterday. Today, we face another trouble. We say, oh God, what is this again? Oh, we begin to talk. God, what kind of life do you give me to live? Oh, we begin to talk heresy. That's what I call heresy, nonsense word to God. And God does not deserve that. There's a song that says, can't your blessings name them one by one? Can't your blessings see what God has done? Can't your blessings name them one by one? And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. I'm telling you, if we can flash back, any child of God that always think back, they are always powerful children of God. When you are always a child of God that can remember the good things the Lord has done, you will always be a powerful child of God. And that will increase your faith all the time. But Christians that always forget, they will not know how to get out of trouble. And that is why God has given me to tell you tonight. Whatever you're going through, there is never, ever going to be any problem you are going through now that is greater than the ones that God has delivered you from. Look at the children of Israel. They got to the wilderness, they forgot about the Red Sea quickly. They forgot about the parting of the Red Sea. Was the parting of the Red Sea lesser than the miracle in the wilderness? Because to me, the parting of the Red Sea, for the Red Sea to roll back, the Bible says the water parted and each of them rolled back. And the dry land was created. And the people passed through the dry land in the mighty ocean. And when they got into the wilderness, they needed food, they forgot the Red Sea. They forgot quickly. Because they were forgetting each by each, step by step of any miracle. Even when the manna came, when they finished eating, they got to another place, they were crying for water. They forgot the manna that fell. And that was why Moses was angry. He said, what kind of people are these? You forget miracle each step. Amen.
Amen.
We must let our previous experience with Christ to increase our present faith and believe in Him. If we always remember what He has done for us, we will always see what we are going through now as minor, a fraction of the trouble.
Amen.
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 And that will give us courage to go on. It will give us courage to go on.
Amen.
John the Baptist forgot every word of God about Jesus just like this because he was in trouble, in prison. Even he forgot that even he himself was a powerful man. When he got to Jesus, Jesus said, oh my God, look at this, my brother. Look at my forerunner. Look at the friend. He was the one that was referred to as the friend of the bridegroom. He was John the Baptist. The friend of the bridegroom, which means he has the same right as the bridegroom. The question we answer in the Bible study, the Sunday school the other day. And that friend of the bridegroom, he forgot his power and authority inside prison. He was captured like Mouton. He was captured in the prison there, and he was sitting down. Many Bible scholars say, no, that is his time. They say many reasons. But what I want to use to preach tonight is what I'm talking about. John the Baptist forgot who he was. He forgot what he had. He forgot what God has used him mightily for. That was why Jesus was reciting those ones. The person that was like this in the wilderness. Look at what he did in the wilderness. He said, who was in the wilderness? Look at that place very well. What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind. But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in a soft garment. Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in the king's houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet. Yes, I say to you, I'm more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written. Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. As surely I say to you, among these, you see, he begins to say many things about this mighty man. And this is the man that forgot so soon. Are you Jesus? In fact, some of us, when we have problems, we say, God, if you are the Lord, the King of Kings, if you are the Lord of Lords, if you are the one that created me, please come and do this. I thought you gave your life to him many years ago. I said, God, I give my life to you. God, I am a new creature. And all of a sudden you forgot that you have been born again, that you gave your life to Jesus. And you are still asking him to reconfirm himself to you. People that do like that, Christians that do like that, they always do like what happened to John. John was there taking offenses, perishing inside his trouble, and before you know it, a small girl, a young girl, damsel, demanded the head of John the Baptist for a party, for a birthday present, because of offense and because he forgot who he was. He forgot what God has used him for. He forgot where he was coming from. He forgot what was his purpose on earth. And the small girl asked for his head as birthday present. It's just like Samson, you know, entertaining his enemy at the end of his days. I pray that you will not entertain your enemies in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your life will not entertain your enemy in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your life will be a challenge and headache to your enemies in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
If there is anything you must do, even in the midst of your problem, always see clear and remember very well. Begin to count what God has done for you. Instead of you thinking in the thought of what He wants to do for you. Because remembering about what He has done for you will help you quickly to get out of what you are thinking that He should do for you. You want me to remember that statement? I mean to repeat it. I said, thinking about what He has done for you will get you out of the thought of what He wants or He can do for you. Because you begin to tell yourself that He has done too much for me. Is it not the Lord that saved me in the valley of the shadow of death? I was supposed to die in 2002, 2003. The Lord spared my life in car accident, in many plane that would have crashed and I would have been dead in the plane, and the Lord saved me and I'm still alive. Many of my age mates are dead and gone and 6 feet below. The Lord helped me out of some trouble situation in business. The Lord provided money for me. He singled me out among my friends and my folks. He put me on a high table to dine and wine with the prince and the princess of this world. Just because of what I need more, I will now lose my hope and my faith in the same God. John the Baptist said, "Are you the one, or we should expect another?" He was lost. Is your problem getting you confused? Many people, when they have problems, they get confused. Say, maybe I'm the worst sinner. My sin is just too much. God cannot listen to me. They forget about their status as a child of God. And they dwell in the thought of confusion, self-judgment, you know, different kind of thing, self-condemnation, and so on and so forth. Amen.
Amen.
So we need to see clearly and to flash back at what God has done for us and not take offense. Do you know some people even take offense with God, like John the Baptist took offense in Jesus? I said, hey, do your home from now. God, if you cannot do it next week, you have lost a son, no? You have just lost a son. Just forget it. Remove my name from that place, because I cannot serve you and die. This is too much for me. And I'm telling you, God is not impressed. He's not impressed by that statement, because he has, for any one son that is gone, he has many what? Many more coming. Everything God wants is just for our own good. So tonight, we begin to think, the reason why I'm saying all these things is to reinforce our trust in God and to always know that we always think about what he has done for us. Because the thought and appreciation of what he has done for you will open door for more things to happen. God is, the reason why some people don't receive, and it's not because of their sin. Some people don't receive anymore because they are ungrateful. You that you are sitting down here, how many of you that can give somebody something? You give somebody something, maybe money or clothes or shoe, and that person see you in the morning. So that person see you the next day, they say, "Hello, my sister, just passed." Your mind just say, "Look at this one. Is it not the one I gave you yesterday?" He didn't even say thank you for that shoe of yesterday. Ah! If you, human being, you think like that, how much more you think God is? Have you forgotten about those lepers that Jesus Christ cleansed them? Have you forgotten about the only one that came back to thank him? Have you forgotten how he was the only one that was permanently cleansed among them? Which means God too recognizes appreciation. He recognizes appreciation. The reason why you don't receive anymore is not only your sin, is because you are a very, very ungrateful person. Imagine somebody that just fell on the floor yesterday. Ah, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. The Lord is wonderful. And the next day, they give the person another letter. Say, hey. Ah, God. No. I don't believe this. I don't believe you don't exist. Ah, if you can do this to me. They hold me. I gave my life to you. And they complain and complain and complain, forgetting about the goodness of yesterday. And I've told you about the man that was waiting 38 years, focusing his attention only on one direction of his healing. And I've told you about John the Baptist expecting his own deliverance from Jesus, and he perished. Anyone, like I said, anyone that have his mindset towards a solution to his problem, they do not get out of those trouble quickly. No matter how much you pray, no matter how much you fast, no matter how much you shake your body and everything, if you put your hope in a solution, you have a picture of where your miracle is coming, that miracle will not come quick. All you have to put all your trust in is in God. God is our trust. God is our confidence. God is our life. God is our being. We live and die for him alone. Our life with him is for glory and purpose. Our death with him also is to go into his glory. Therefore, wherever we go through, when we are prayed, I love that. I always talk about that Bible passage. That's 1 John 5, 17. Amen. He said, now. He didn't say later. Now, just like he said, when you know, when you are talking about definition of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. He said, now faith, therefore. And this one says too, he says also, now. This is the confidence that we have in him. Now, this is the confidence, if you read it, if it's like that in your own Bible. 14, sorry, I was saying 17. 1 John 5, 14. It says, now, 1 John 5, 14. Now, this is the confidence that we have in him. That if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. 1 John 5, 14. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And there are many children of God that ask many things according to his will. It looks like God does not hear them. Because they are ungrateful children. They are happy today, unhappy tomorrow. They are grateful today, they are not grateful again tomorrow. How many times have you praised God in your situation? How many times have you seen yourself in terrible situation and you begin to kneel down, begin to roll on the floor and worshiping God and praising God without crying? Amen. That is one of my wife can bear me witness, that's one of my weapon. There's no problem that trouble me. God has not given me a problem that is higher than what I can handle. And that is what the Bible says. God can never give anyone a trouble that you cannot handle. If I say it, it might be something that you can say, you can never handle it. But God gives everybody according to your ability. In the midst of trouble, I worship God. Even in this place that we call Europe, that we think everything should be going on well and smooth, when there was a time when things were very rough with the ministry in Castuba at that time, and everything, things was very, very rough with our business, with the ministry that we were sent to, and supporting the ministry, supporting the business. Before we know it, our house was affected. I told some of you the story. We didn't have light in the house for 4 months. In this place, 4 months we didn't have our light in the house. Our electricity was disconnected. 4 months. It's not that we didn't have the money, but we had to pay for the rent of the church. We have to pay some bills in the church and the business, and at the expense of our own house. And every night we will be worshiping God. Every night we'll be rolling on the floor. Every night we'll be praising God. Even in the cold weather, we'll bath with cold water. We had a way of using it. We'll sleep with heavy blanket in the cold. Put the mattress on the floor so that everybody will heat ourselves up. We'll sleep on the same area. And we'll still be jumping. Everybody can bear witness. The children are here to witness it. Their mother is here to witness it. We'll be shouting and rolling and screaming and praising the Lord in the darkness. And nobody in their school knew that they didn't have light for 4 months. And we were going to school every day. They were going to school. We were washing clothes in the public place, doing everything public, cooking in the office place. We cook, take our cooking stuff to the business place, cook in the room and everything. And we were rolling and we were praising God. And we'll be shouting. Some night we'll do night vigil, the whole house will be shaking. Dancing and laughing as if we did in the under candle. We were using candle. The shop that is selling candle, they knew that they had customer. Because we're just chattering the candle. But when the examination was over, when the test was over, the Bible says, when the Lord restored all the lost of Israel, it was like what? It was like them that dream it. It was like them that dream it. Everything was just set to back, 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 back. And we had enough and we had excess to keep. That's the way God is. And the way he did it in the way that we knew, all of us knew that this is God. Nobody shared the glory. Not even the ministry that sent us to that place did anything to support. But God showed up that I am the Lord. I change it not.
Amen.
I am the Lord of yesterday, the Lord of today, the Lord of tomorrow. The first check we received in the post, we didn't go to any office to apply for anything. The check, we just saw a letter. I saw my name, my middle name, my family name on the check. I didn't know where the check came from. It was close to exact amount we needed to pay for our ESB. We just needed to add a few hundred to it and the light will come. But we didn't use it for the light. Some people will just quickly grab the check and go and pay for their light. We didn't use it for the light. I don't want to go into the story of what we use it for. We still waited. You know, my wife was saying that, what kind of thing is this? The only thing we have to go and sort the light quick now. Are you happy the way the children and the... We didn't use it for the light. I'm telling you. When you see people that God bless, they do some stupid things that you can never do. They do some crazy thing that you can never do. That is why God has blessed them. As you are sitting down here, can you be out of light desperately and God give you the money for the light and you go and use it for another thing? Nobody can do that. No way. They will say, I beg, if Monte will come back, nobody will collect this check from you. I have to sort my problem first. Please, I want you to believe the Lord that we preach, that we know. When you see some Christian children of God, we are getting to that, we will start praying now. When we see many children of God, we claim God. We talk wonderful about Him. We talk very much. You know, I used to listen to believers when we talk in churches, on the TV. I see many Christian children of God talking. We praise God. We love Him. We worship Him. But when we are in the field of play, when we are face to face with trouble, when the Goliath face us face to face, we deny to be like David. We even lose the battle before we start fighting. Brothers and my people, I want you, please. We don't just... The word of God is not for us to just speak or just read. It's for us to live it. It's for us to live it. It's not for us to read and just speak. It's for us to live it. Live the word. Let the people that are around you, your family, your friends, let them know that you are living what you believe. You stand for what you preach. You stand for what you say. You stand for what you read. Amen.
Amen.
The same people, I will show you different kind of people now that fell into the problem that John the Baptist fell into. Acts chapter 12. I will close on those three. Remain one, then I will close very soon. Acts of Apostles chapter 12 from verse 1. Another person, 16 to 25.
Act 12, verse 1.
From verse 1. Yes.
Now, by that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands and persecuted certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of a living bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending after the Passover to bring him forth to the people. Peter therefore was kept in prison. That prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, back with two chains, and the guy before the door kept before the door, kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hand. And the angel said unto him, bind yourself, and bind your sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast your garments about you, and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and knew not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. Verse 10. When they were past the first and the second guard, they came unto the iron gate that led unto the city, which opened to them of its own accord, and they went out and passed up one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark. There Mary, they gathered together, praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a maid came to answer, named Rhoda.
Amen. It's okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Shut the gate for gladness.
Amen. It's okay, ma'am. Amen.
Amen.
So you see the case of Peter. Peter too was in the situation that, amen. Peter was in the situation that John the Baptist was here. Peter too was apprehended. He was kept in the prison awaiting his own death. Peter too was kept in prison awaiting his own death. But in his case, he had prayed and he left the matter to Christ. He left the matter to God for intervention. And the church was also praying fervently for him. But Peter did not take offense in the church. He did not even say, why is it that one of the disciples, my friends, didn't come to see me? Why did they, you know, begin to take offense and offense? Offense is a terrible thing. That was what caused, if you ask me, after I read that story of John the Baptist clearly and very, very carefully, I discovered that offense destroyed the man's calling. Probably he had a little bit more time. But some people will say he has finished his job. That's why he left. I don't share that kind of opinion. But offense caught ministry. It destroyed ministry. It destroyed prayer. It does not allow prayer to come to pass. So he was offended. He was expecting much from Jesus. All his hope was built on Jesus coming to bail him out or speaking a word to release him. But here is Peter, prayed, minding his business, believing that God is able, because he promised that if you are in the middle of fire, he will do what? He will be there with you. He believed his word, expecting miracle, and the miracle eventually came. The Bible said angel did not need to open door before he got to the prison. Angel appeared. But because Peter was a martyr, angel had to open gates for them to go back. But angel did not open gates to come in. They don't need to open gate. They are immortal. He came in without opening gate, but when they took Peter by the hand, the Bible says the gates were opening according by themselves.
Amen.
The padlock broke. The chain broke. Each gate opened by themselves as they were coming. But it was the only angel that wanted to come back, there will not be need for gate to open. But because Peter had to go out with him, so, oh Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Amen.
You don't know the strength of God we serve. We don't know it. We don't have an idea of the God. I'm telling you about angel. I'm not talking about Jesus. It was angel that came to deliver, was sent to deliver Peter. An angel held Peter by the hand, look at the padlock, bah, he passed. Get to the second one, bah, they don't need any hammer. There was, armor was not needed. Saw was not needed. Only to look and think. You know, once they think, this is what I want to get done, go, it broke. Go, that one broke. Go. That, immediately they think about, this is what I want to do, it will happen in the physical. Amen.
Amen.
That is the way we must live our life as children of God. Pray. Believe strongly in your heart. You know, the answer to the prayer comes from the inside. After you have done the prayer, it comes from the strength of your inside. Say, this has to be done. That is what the faith is. Your faith comes from the inside your heart. And the faith push out what you pray for. You have prayed and you now realize this has to be done. Nobody can do that for you. And every person that the Bible mentions, every story of healing, of deliverance that the Bible mentions, those are the people that had faith. Especially apart from the ones, some like that man sitting at the pool of Bethesda that received his own healing by grace. That's why I said I will still go back to that story to close soon before we go into the prayer. Amen.
Amen.
And let me read the second story before I put up, I put together the two stories. 16:25. Acts 16:25. Chapter 16, verse 16-25.
Acts 16:15. And when she was baptized and her household.
Verse 16. Now it happened as he went to prayer. That's what started. Chapter 16, verse 16-25.
Okay, sorry.
Not 15.
Okay.
Now I read it. Now it happened as we went to prayers that a certain slave girl possessed. Now we have to jump off from the story. I go straight to 25. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake. Earthquake where? The earthquake in the prison. So that the foundations of the prison were shaking, and immediately, all the doors were open and everyone's chains were loose. 27. And the keeper of the prison awaking from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoner had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called him in a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light, ran in and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Amen.
Amen.
The answer that your faith provoked, it wins a soul to Christ, to the body of Christ. And that is why I know and I confirm that God is willing to fulfill what he promised about your life.
Yes.
That is why I know God wants to do that miracle in your lives. Because he wants to do that which will convince other people to come to him. Because without signs and wonders and miracles, people do not believe anymore in this generation. And for that reason, God is willing every day to do something special and spectacular in your life that will touch the heart of one unbeliever that will come to him. But because the person that God himself want to bless does not have the level of faith to provoke the blessing. Amen.
Amen.
We pray will do everything, and your unbelieving friend will just say to you, with all your prayers. That is what. That's the reason why me, I want to do extraordinary thing. I don't want unbelievers to tell me with all your prayer. Look at your life. I don't like that statement. And that is why I search Bible and say, what must I do to live extraordinary life? Because the Bible says, those who know their law will be do what? Will be strong and do what? Do exploit. There is two things. One thing is to know about God. Another thing is to know God. Which one do you belong to? Do you know God or you know about him? A lot of people know about God. Oh, they quote many things about him. They can say anything about him. They can read anything about him. They can preach about him. But they do not know him. That was what Jesus was talking about John the Baptist. After all seen and done, this man could still talk like this. He said, this is supposed to be the greatest man. But I tell you, the lowest in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist because of all this act. The lowest in heaven, in the kingdom of heaven, is greater than John the Baptist. And therefore he says, since the day of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God do what? Sovereign violence. And only the violent do what?
Take care by force.
And I'm telling you, that's what it means. So it doesn't mean any, that word, that statement does not mean any other thing. Because some people translate it to many things. This heaven, if you want to make it, as a child of God, you want to pass through this world that we are passing through. This is a journey. This is a process. It's a journey that we are passing through. And in the process of time, in the passing through of the journey, we have to do many things. You need to survive. We say we are not of the world, but we live in the world anyway for this time being. We have to eat. You have to wear clothes. We have to transport yourself to work and come back. You need to take care of your family members and friends and relatives while you are living. Therefore, you are not a spirit. You are in flesh and body. Therefore, the kingdom becomes violent. And if you are not violent, you will not be able to get there.
Hallelujah.
That's what he says.
I will get there in Jesus' name.
It takes violence. It takes violence. You need to be violent and angry. We don't need to give up like John the Baptist did and gave up inside prison. We need to put our strength. No! This is not going to happen. I do not settle for this. It cannot happen to me. And for you to do that, you must do extraordinary things. Crazy things. I'm not saying mad people, forgive that language. I mean things that are beyond human reasoning. Faith that beyond human reasoning. What the kind of faith that woman cannot think about. The kind of faith that human being cannot comprehend. That's the kind of thing I'm talking about. The things you know that you cannot naturally do. You don't even have power or resources or to do it. But you take a step of faith to say, I must do this. But in most cases, we live by sight. Many children of God live by sight. We don't live by faith. And we claim, we can talk faith, we can claim faith, we can discuss faith. But when it comes to reality, when it comes to face to face, we lack faith. We lack faith. We must live by the faith we know and that we are taught, that we read in the Bible. We must leave it. This is the time. It is when you get to the examination or you prove what you have read, what you have been taught, what you have studied. You put it on the paper and that's where you pass your exam. Because your exam comes with another blessing. When you pass each exam, even the one I'm still doing, as I'm talking to you, I'm still doing writing some papers, some exam. And when it's over, you will still see the color that it came with. Because every exam you pass, it comes with another blessing. But how are you prepared? What is your level of preparedness for this examination that you are doing? Are you really prepared? Are you really doing any exam? Or you are just sitting down, you don't even want to write it because it's too tough for you. You need to get out of one space. You are, that man stayed 38 years in one position. Under a house suspended by, under a house of mercy, suspended by grace. He had mercy. He had grace. But he could not get his healing. He could not get out of the situation. Grace gives you what you are not merited, an unmerited favor. Grace, when they said they give somebody something by grace, mercy and grace was available, yet the man did not receive healing. Once in a while, the pool can be steered. But do you want to wait for the pool to be steered before you get your deliverance and miracle? Are you the one that wants the pool to be steered? Can you afford to wait for that long? I don't want to wait for that long. Today in the morning, I was telling my wife that we talk about this issue. I said, this is the message for tonight in the night vigil. In the morning, we're dropping the children in the morning. I said, some children of God wait for the water to be steered. They don't have enough faith to break through. They don't have what it takes to take the kingdom by force. They don't have that violent faith, a crazy faith. That kind of faith, I told you that somebody, you need the money to pay for the bill to have light and you didn't pay it. You went to put it in another place to sort another trouble. And you still continue saying that, say, this is not what we need. And eventually, 2 weeks, how many weeks after? 2 weeks or 3 weeks after, we had more than enough in another miraculous way. In fact, I was, if not because my name was on that chalk and my address and my family middle name, everything was complete, I would have said, in fact, I don't even know where to call. Because I didn't know where to call to even ask whether this is me for me or not. Because it didn't come with any number. Not even any phone number to call. But I believe God is still in the miracle. He's on the seat. I am a living witness. Like I said, if only testimony of my life to share, many people will give their life to Christ. Because I'm a living witness. When people give the testimony, cannot come unless you live in faith. Faith is what brings testimony. Testimony cannot come. And that's the reason why I'm telling us all this. Your testimony cannot come unless your faith triggers the testimony. God is training his children. God is the one that promised Abraham. I always told us, chapter 12 of Genesis. And he did not fulfill his promises, even up to chapter 17, when he was 19, after 25 years old. He did not fulfill it. Because Abraham did not have enough faith that required to produce Isaac at that stage. I want to tell you, finally, before we go into prayer, God is not a deaf God. We are not serving statue. We are not serving statue. We are serving human being. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Lion of Judah, the Everlasting Father, the Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha. That's the one we are serving. The one that, the owner of heaven and the earth, the one that holds all the kings of this world in his hand like this.
Amen.
The one that got the key to the kingdom of the heaven and heart. And he said to you, look, today I have given you the key to the kingdom. Oh, you didn't see that in your own Bible. I found it in my own. I gave you the key to the kingdom. Anything you bind here on earth shall be do what? Shall be bound in heaven. Anything you lose here on the earth shall be do what? Lose in heaven. If two or three of you shall agree together on hand, asking anything in my name, believing that you will receive it, you shall have it. That's what it says. That's what it says. Believing that you can have it, you will have it. Unless you don't believe it. And I just told you, all this miracle, I can tell you the story of my life from beginning to the end. I will not finish. And everything leads to faith. I have done a business of 40 something thousand from nothing. I told you the story before. I didn't have anything. It was absolutely out of faith. Even to pay for the rent, I didn't have deposit. And the business started. And the computers came. And the machine came. And everything I needed came. And today, as I'm standing here, I don't have anybody that I have to pursue to pay for anything. Like I told you last time, unless few on the computers. God set you everything for me. From no, I didn't have even, I told you, I did not pay deposit of the rent before I got the key. That is faith. You know, faith makes you talk with confidence. Instead of people to mock you, they will just laugh and they wouldn't know what they are doing, they will just give you. Because you are talking in, you know, do you know the way the kings talk? If you are close to any king, you will know the way they talk. The Bible says, where the word, my sister, you read it on Sunday, where the word of a king is, what is there? Where the word of a king is, in that Ecclesiastes chapter 8.
There is authority.
Thank you. Where the word of a king is, there is what? Authority. Ecclesiastes, if you read it from chapter 8, from verse 2 to 5. Where the word of a king is, there is authority. And as a child of God, you don't know what you carry. A child of God behaves like a child of a pauper. I want you to understand what I'm saying regarding this. All the children of God that the Bible recognizes, those Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Moses, name them. The reason why the Bible recorded them is because they behave strangely. And they talk with authority. Because they knew their God. And they did exploit. My sister, my people tonight, get out of lukewarmness. Get out of where you are sitting now. Get serious. Take the kingdom by violence. Don't let people rob you of your right because of your that's the way it is. To the glory of God. The Department of Justice give you a letter. He said, okay, God, Baba, you see the letter, I come again. There was a man of God that told a story on the TV. He was in England. They gave him a letter to go back home. They refused his application from the Home Office. And the pastor took paper. He said, first of all, the person that sent this letter will know no peace. I am a man of God. I came here. I have to start my ministry. He quoted Bible verse that said, the Lord is the Lord. The heart is the Lord. And the fullness thereof. You have no right to ask me to leave this country. This land belongs to my father. He has sent me here. I am planting a church here, if you don't know. And if you want peace, you better withdraw this statement and know how you will arrange it. Because I have to get my paper. With authority, with boldness. And I cannot remember so many other things that he put in the letter. He said it, I heard from him on the TV. And he sent, when he finished the letter, he sent it back to them. Do you know what came back after the letter? They said, we are very sorry. You have been granted your leave to remain. He didn't look for any lawyer. He didn't look for anybody to go and fight the case. But he exercised his right. The Bible says, when you know your God, you will do exploit. Take the kingdom by violence. Just take it. Behave stubbornly. Behave as if you are not normal for once. And you will see what God will do. We wait until we have problems before we talk abnormally. We don't need to wait until you are pushed to the airport before you talk. Look at my sister here that is listening to us from Dublin. You know, she got to the airport before she began to speak all those powerful words. I will not go home. This land is for my father. No way! I am a child of God. She began to claim everything. And finally, they set up and said, Your child, your father has set you free. Go home. Amen. That is what God can do. We have to do it. Don't wait until that happens. Take your pen. Take your pen. When they write you, reply them. Put some Bible passages. Let them know what they don't know. Let them read the letter and begin to shake. But with wisdom. I'm not saying you threaten their life. With wisdom and some words that will keep them off balance. And I'm telling you, they will be passing the letter to one person and the other. They will be shaking, saying, what kind of thing is this? Who is this person? What kind of, we have never received this kind of reply before. What kind of woman being are these people? Another person will say, I got one last week too. I don't know which, you know, these people begin to spring up now. They said they put the letter, they said they are born again or something. And some of them are even coming to us to confess, to do restitution. And they are putting these strange words in the letter. You know why people, do you know the way they behave? They said, these people are strange. And you know, Before you know it, you say, just give them their this thing, sort them out, let them begin to go wherever they want to. If you want to go, amen.
Amen.
They have no right. The only reason why it cannot happen is your faith. It's your strength. It's your stubbornness. If you are weak, it will not happen. You must take the kingdom by violent. You must take the kingdom by violent. Let's rise on our feet. Every prayer that we pray without corresponding action, it cannot make things happen. That is the summary of everything. The man was sitting at the pool. I'm telling you, if he left the comfort of the shade and sat close to the water, the pool, at least he was able to crawl. If he could not walk, he would crawl, even move on his bum, walk, move himself forward, move to the pool side, and stay there even in the rain, in the sun. Say, you know, somebody that needs miracle, you don't expect any comfort. Miracle that you need is more important than your comfort. You will sit down in the rain, sit down in the sun. Everybody will call you, say, no, I will not leave this place. I will never let you go unless you bless me. I will never let you go unless you bless me. It is only in this Europe I see people that have problems. I will pray like a priest. They have serious problems and we will just be taking things easy. Lord Father, hallelujah. You know, it's just a little of those things, you know. And they'll be telling God, and God will just look at some people and say, I'm sorry for you. I'm sorry for you. If that man, I told you, stay in that rain, if he left the comfort of that shade and sat down beside the pool, close to the water, and everybody said, leave there, say, no, I will not leave. Go away, it rains. He said, no, I will stay here. And because I don't know when the miracle will be. And immediately he said, probably the water is just a matter of roll. It's just a matter of roll inside. You don't need anybody to carry you because you're already there. You're like, probably, go away. You just turn your body inside the water. And you get your healing. But the man sat with other people that could walk. You know, somebody that needs miracle, you sit down with people that are okay. And probably eating with them. They will just look at this one. It's just like somebody that go and borrow money. You know, you want to borrow money. And you got there, they were making nice food, nice salad and rice. And they say, my sister, do you need something? He said, oh, yes. They serve you. They gave you food and everything you are eating and drinking. And somebody else came and said, they say, oh, my brother, you too, you came. Sit down, please. Let's give you something. Say, ah, no. Please, can I see you, sir? And the brother went to go and see the man. And the brother left. Say, ah, my brother, you are going quick. Say, ah, I'm going quick. Thank God. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So the one that was sitting did not know what happened. He just knew that the man was thanking the owner of the house and left quickly and rushed out. So he now finished eating and drinking. And I said, hey. Amen. When he finished eating, he said, hey, sir, you know, before we begin to say another thing, I need your help, sir. You know, I need some money to solve one problem. He said, ah, you need money and you have been eating. Do you see that man that just went now? The one that just met you eating. He came for the same problem. And I've given him all the money I have. He said, ah, why was I eating? Because the man said, yes, it's because the food is important than the money you want. Otherwise, if you are so much in need of money, you will not come here and begin to eat and drink. You see that man? We said he should eat, he didn't eat. Even he collected the money, he rushed out, he didn't steal them. That's the way you're supposed to have done. If you have a trouble that you don't want in your life, you need to behave strangely. You need to behave strangely. You act strangely. You behave strangely. Your faith will be more than every other person's faith. And you begin to move towards the direction of that trouble in your faith. And you see what God can do. If you want to ask yourself today, do I have testimony? Do I have challenging testimony in my life? Have I ever even experienced any serious testimony about my life? If you have not, then you need to behave the way I'm telling you tonight. Strange faith produces strange testimony. What did I say? Strange faith produces strange testimony. Stubborn faith produces stubborn deliverance. It makes you receive stubborn, it makes stubborn problems leave your life. But if you have soft faith and you have stubborn problem, then it's not good enough. Look at David. David came, all his senior brothers and every giant people in Israel, they were sitting miles away from where Goliath was. And everybody, the Bible says for some days Goliath was there. Goliath was just talking against, he was just talking and talking. Nobody was able to come near him. And David, the small boy, just came and said, why is everybody looking at this uncircumcised Philistine to talk to you like that? A small boy. Amen.
Amen.
So we will pray tonight and the Lord will do it again. Lord will do it again, for he has done it before. He came from heaven, he will do all the things he will do. You bring me to the Lord, for your moment of joy has come. Sing hallelujah, my Lord will do it again. Lord will do it again, for he has done it before. He came from heaven, he will do what he says he will do. Give glory to the Lord, your moment of joy has come. Sing hallelujah, my Lord will do it again. He will do it, he will do it. Oh yeah, he will do it again. Hallelujah, he will do it. My Lord will do it again. He will do it, hallelujah.